It's no secret that all the studios and networks in Hollywood absolutely hate Netflix. Netflix has so much money that they hire away executives from the competitors. They're able to outbid everybody for mostly TV shows at this point, because Netflix's one problem area so far has been movies. So a lot of people are like, well, you have more money, but nobody will see my movie if it debuts on your streaming service. But still, Netflix has turned Hollywood into the upside down. So I'm sure that everybody else is giving a lot of nods to Warner Brothers, saying, good job. Because Warner Brothers, I think, has dealt a significant blow to Netflix's, you know, crown jewel. It used to be House of Cards, and it was Orange is the New Black for a while. And Stranger Things, though, has emerged as, you know, the top show on the streaming service. But then, of course, Warner Brothers went and released It about 2 months prior to the release of season two. Interestingly enough, the Duffer Brothers wanted to make It, and Stranger Things, the first season, was how they dealt with the rejection. But, you know, Warner Brothers and the producers of It rallied, and, you know, it was funny. Remember, for a while, they were like, did you like Stranger Things? Then you're going to like It. And that indeed was the case. The other thing is, and I think this is, by the way, it's a shame, the final trailer for Stranger Things, I think, is the weakest one they've released. Not the best way to go into your episodes. But also, I think that they have a little bit of a Harry Hart problem. Whereas Harry Hart was what everybody was interested in for Kingsman 2, everybody's interested in 11. And both ad campaigns aren't focusing on the character that everybody loves. I'm sure some of you are like, well, I don't agree, Grace. I love this character. Or I, for the most part, you know, this is a mass market business, right? So while I'm sure they are fans of many of the characters, and I like many of the characters, although we'll talk about David Harbour when we get to him. I think he's hurt his career. But 11 is by far and away the main event. And so I think I think you don't want to give too much away, but to bench her so much, I think, is a mistake. One that they could regret in hindsight. So let's break it down. This is our last stop before we arrive in Hawkins ourselves. All right. So we start out in the upside down with all that snowy ash. It's very Blade Runner-y. I would love it if Kay walked up to her. Now, I don't know how these Egos are able to go through, because then she could just walk to the supermarket. And also, in real life, she'd need a little bit of a better balanced nutrition situation here. But anyway, I love that this is an old nod. Reagan Bush, 84! I think that's fun. Now, this was funny. Now, this is a beautiful shot with the tombstones, but it was really weird to see it because we just saw a very similar shot in the New Mutants trailer, which I really liked. That was actually like my favorite shot in the New Mutants trailer. This is a fun one, talking, you know, showing how, you know, Halloween is both fun and ominous. But in the New Mutants one, it was straight ominous because, you know, everybody was buried and marked by number. They didn't even have names. This, I wonder if the little, like, squiggly design at the top of these two tombstones is a nod to what's coming to Hawkins. But I think this is very charming. And it's a very good use of light. Stranger Things, to me, is all about the use of light. We'll talk about that in terms of Spielberg when we get to the right shot. But to me, that's when this show works best, you know, having a glow factor to it. And when it's not glowing, I don't think it's as strong. And so they should really, you know, pay attention to that from a visual perspective. Like, there's some more glowing. It's beautiful. So darn it, there's Will Byers having passed into the upside down again. He's like, he's always distracted. He's never paying attention. He's like that friend who always seems out of it, but is actually being sucked into another dimension. So maybe you should be a little bit more, understanding. But I think that, you know, obviously they're going trick-or-treating. We'll talk about there's a funny thing about the Ghostbusters uniforms that I think is very interesting. But, you know, we'll be lost on many. But we'll see if it's highlighted in the trailer. But just this shot is very beautiful. And it's why we like the Upside Down. Although I have to say, I want to see a progression in the sequel in terms of what's in the Upside Down, our understanding of the Upside Down, and also Eleven's powers. You know, when you move forward, the mystery not only has to deepen, and characters not only have to have arcs, but certain things have to progress. You know, slow burns only work for so long, you know, especially because they have more episodes this time around. I really need to see movement in that regard. So he's like, oh, crap. Oh, yeah. So, all right. So this is important. I'm not so into that big squiggly monster, by the way. I'm not like, ooh, whatever. Okay. So this is a journalist, apparently, according to some of the information that's been released previously. And he's come to Hawkins to investigate a cold case. I'm guessing Barb, right? I think that's probably what it's going to be. So here we see Nancy, who really looks different, by the way. She looks, I don't know, I'm not sure if I like it as much. She's missing the quality, I think, that made her a good match with Jonathan. I think they're a great couple. As much as I like Steve, this is the couple I'm rooting for. I don't know. It seems like she's matured and changed a lot, but Jonathan looks exactly the same. I mean, sometimes that happens to people, and maybe it'll be commented on, but I don't know. They don't seem as good a match anymore, which makes me a little sad. So you can see here, this is the guy's crazy board. You've seen it in so many things at this point. It's, you know, people use it as comedic references. But he's done a lot of research. You can see a portrait of 11 over there with her old hairstyle. Needs to be updated, buddy. Then for some reason, he has these notes about, you know, school, pick up Nancy Wheeler, who's in the room. She's probably like, that's creepy. You know, park and leave car, then go to the Harrington house, of course, where Steve lives. So I don't know if this guy maybe is interacting with them under false pretenses to begin with. We'll see. But he's decided to bring them into his circle. It's a little bit like Riverdale, where the police officer and the adults are always asking these high school kids for help solving crimes. You're like, no, you got to be a legitimate department. It's like I was watching the season premiere of Riverdale, season two, and the police chief, so incompetent on that show, was like, what do you think, Jughead? Do you think you could use your contacts with the serpent gang to see if you can maybe do my job for me? I was like, come on, all right? So anyway, here you can see they're going to school in costume. They seem to be the only ones who decided to do that today. I hope they don't have too rough a day. Although Ghostbusters outfits are pretty awesome. This is one of the things that I wanted to reference. Now keep this in mind. We'll get to the other movie when we get there. But Ghostbusters actually came out between season one and season two in the world of the show. Came out June 1984. And this takes place 1 year later, Halloween 1984. So that's very, very clever. 1984, it turns out, was a great year for movies. Okay, but I don't want to give it away. You might be able to predict it. There's Steve hanging. He's like, wow, I've really changed. I'm hanging out with these little kids. That's Max, the new female character there. I'm not at all in favor of adding, and we'll see how nice she is, if she's a fun character, but I'm not into adding more kids. They had too many kids last time, as I said in my live reaction. They didn't have enough time to give them the attention that they need. So I don't know why you would add more. I like Steve, though. The reason I like Steve so much is that I thought it was such a nice change of pace to have, like, the jerky cool kid, like, kind of, like, become, like, a, like, realize that's who he was and, like, step up to the plate and become a nicer person and realize that there were, you know, at first he was like, Nancy, you're making a fool out of me and that's all that matters. And then he was like, no, obviously something more important is happening here. My relationship status be damned. And I thought that was great. I thought, you know, the evolution of Steve Harrington was one of the best parts of the first. Like, they were like, you came back! And that was just so amazing. So I really want to make sure that gets attention here. So they're obviously doing some investigating in the woods. I love that. That's such a classic 1980s. I think, you know, The Shining has that. It's like, it's really an awesome shot. It's very cool. It has a rich cinematic history. There they're like, why did we get the same haircut again? Now, it's going to be weird having Finn Wolfhard go back to playing such a demure character, because he was so wonderful as Richie in It. So it's going to be like, I think a lot of us will be watching and be like, okay, you can make a great joke now. All right, we're ready. And instead he's going to be like, no, I'm quiet here. And everyone's like, that's never good. We already have a quiet one over there. We don't need two of you. You know, that was one of the things, you know, it'd be interesting to see what the Will Byers effect is, because Will was more of like an idea, in the first season. He wasn't a character. So I'll be curious to see if he and Mike end up canceling each other out. So I have to tell you, oh, by the way, Winona Ryder looks overprocessed too. I'm not quite sure what's going on. But I'll just bring it up here. I really like David Harbour. I thought he was such, again, another wonderful revelation in the first season, because he's not the kind of actor you'd usually cast in such a role. And I thought he was absolutely fantastic. I mean, he's supposed to be modeled after Chief Brody from Jaws, and I think he does a great job capturing that. However, he has been so aggressive with his political statements during award season that, you know, whether you agree with him or not, it just really kind of was a little off-putting, and it was so intense that I'm having a hard time seeing past it. I'm having suddenly a hard time seeing the character. I'm like, oh, okay, look, we just tell, you know, let's just tell the story. And so I can, you know, and I said that I wanted to see him in Hellboy, you know, with his makeup. Maybe they were right to hide him. They're like, oh, but just layer on some more makeup till you're unrecognizable. It's for your craft, David. It's for your craft. I just think, this is one of the reasons. I think that it's fine to make a political statement and stand up for something here and there, but when you become so aggressive, you have to be careful that it doesn't become your persona, because it just makes it a little bit hard to see you as anything else. Now, apparently they've created a love triangle between Sean Astin, David Harbour, and Winona Ryder. Why is this facility still here? I'd be like, I mean, I guess they have no, the government's like, yeah, we're keeping it there. What are you going to do about it? But still, that's just crazy. You think people would move. So it's the classic decontamination stuff. I liked this shot. I wish they had more stuff like this with the smoke and the shadowy figures, with the old technology. That stuff's really great. That's what Stranger Things is supposed to be all about. I like that a lot. It's a little kind of like 80s, but also like a little, I don't know, X-Files-y or something like that, or you know, Twin Peaks. You know, I think that creepy eeriness is something that differentiates it from It, which I think was never particularly cinematic. It was more about the characters and the really great performances and the writing. But It was never this cinematic. And so that's something that sets this apart. And I think they should lean on that more heavily. Maybe they do. There he is all by himself in the hallway. But I don't know why she's wearing a hospital smock. Is she staying with him or something? And I don't know. There's just something, I don't know. Maybe because I've seen David Harbour scream a lot. I don't want to see anybody scream. And you get more flies with honey than vinegar, Winona Ryder. But she's like, what's wrong with my boy? Now, this is great. This is a great shot. Because, you know, J.J. Abrams, of course, has famously modeled himself after Steven Spielberg. But J.J. Abrams, of course, is famous for lens flare. Well, Steven Spielberg is famous for beams of light. It's his favorite thing to do. And you particularly notice it in his earlier movies. There's a magical quality about it. And again, they've used light very effectively in Stranger Things Season 1. And Steven Spielberg, like if you watch the beginning of E.T., you know, any of his movies, Jaws, Close Encounters, he's all about beams of light. And it's very effective, even to this day, as you can see. So I like the way they're using it here. And you can see these are the flashlights on all these suited guys' scopes in the upside down, and they all draw on something at once. And it's very cool. It's another great atmospheric shot. So there's Will. You know, I'll be curious. It's tough for this actor. He can't really connect with the audience because this whole thing is that he's disconnected. So he's going to have to really work hard during those upside down sequences to, you know, let us in. Paul Reiser. Paul Reiser's great. Such a great choice for this. Paul Reiser's hilarious. Paul Reiser was like, I don't know if you heard this story. I think I recounted it when he was first cast. Because, you know, of course, he's being brought in here because of his work, like, on Aliens, right? He was the company representative. And he said, Jim Cameron cast me because he thought I looked really trustworthy. And I thought that was hilarious because I was like, few people look less trustworthy than Paul Reiser. Like, anything Paul Reiser, if Paul Reiser says, oh, you're going to be okay, you'd be like, I am not going to be okay. He just has this smarmy corporate look to him. Not so much here, though. He seems a little bit sweeter. I'm not quite sure what's going on there. He looks like he's crossed over into James Spader territory. They look very similar, actually. So they're like, yeah, we're both weird. You always got me. 11 got us. Now here, she's using her TK to open the door. And you can see, she could have, you know what? I guess she's doing it for effect. But I'd be like, hey, 11, I can see how strenuous that was for you just to lift the latch. You can open the door with your hand. That's fine. You know, conserve your telekinetic energy, because obviously you're coming into this house for a reason and they don't want you in there. Or maybe she's just breaking in. I don't know. But just use the TK when you need it. And I hope that she gets better. Again, I want to see some progression with this character beyond her hairstyle. She's still dressing very androgynously, though. That's an interesting choice. Again, not really. It's a Winona Ryder. I'm not really into this this thing. I guess that's the tentacles going all over town. Meh. There they are. Oh, I liked this, by the way. So they're in here, and you can see the tentacles are everywhere. Not as cool as Christmas lights, but you see all the string. At first, I was like, oh, somebody has a craft hobby. But maybe that's for crazy theory boards, right? They're like, oh, we got all every different color string here. We can have all kinds of conspiracies. It's like, ah, the arts, you know, arts and craft stores. Surprisingly, also for your conspiracy theorists. So there's Sean Astin, who's dating Winona Ryder's character. There's Paul Reiser. Look at that expression. I just noticed that now. Paul Reiser's so like, can we get her out of this room, please? Now that's the Paul Reiser we all want to see. He's like, I don't care about this kid. And this is really distracting. Maybe he also feels Sean Astin's being very unprofessional. He's like, come on. Keep it at home, buddy. There's David Harbour. He's in the Upside Down, not wearing a hazmat suit. Sometimes he wears them, sometimes he doesn't. Paul Reiser, again. I love this shot. Okay, so they're all like, so these things are obviously activated by something that's happening. And so Paul Reiser and the other tech with the glasses are all like, you know, horrified, amazed. We love our job. That guy in the middle is awesome. He's like, I hate my job. He's going to be the first one out of there. He's going to be backing out of the room while everybody else is like, what do you think's happening here? He's like, you be sure to, well, there's no email back then. You be sure to, you know, send out a memo, fax me, page me. So I guess this is more conspiracy theory stuff. Now that's interesting. That's like some crazy portal. They're like, that's Barbara. That's all that's left of Barbara. I don't even know what's going on there. I'd be like, the modern art aspects of the Upside Down were fun at first, but it's too abstract for me, man. So I like that she's like, why does always only weird things bring us together? And he's like, why are we in separate beds? I know why they bring you together. You guys should be dating already. So there is, okay. Date night for Winona Ryder and Sean Astin. That's Steve Harrington. But here, this is obviously a Karate Kid nod. I thought maybe it was Rambo bandanas, big in the 80s, but Karate Kid came out the same, not only the same year, 1984, but the same month as Ghostbusters. Isn't that amazing? Ghostbusters came out at the beginning of June 1984, and Karate Kid came out at the end of 1984. That's a real Sophie's choice for them in terms of their Halloween costumes. They went Ghostbusters, but obviously the Duffer Brothers didn't have to choose. He's gonna wax on, wax off the Upside Down. So now David Harbour is in a hazmat suit. They're back on a school bus again. Sean Astin. It's pretty good running, Sean Astin. I'm impressed. He's got some medical stuff. Oh, look at all those dead bodies behind him. Oh, that's cool. I didn't see that before. Awesome. One of my favorite things, like the first season got off to such an amazing start when they had that beginning with the underground facility and that guy running for his life. That was really fantastic. I hope they have more cool stuff like that. Being in the office late at night is indeed very creepy. So yeah, they're like, we need all the kids we can get. No, you don't. You guys are talking yourselves out of screen time. So again, David Harbour. A little bit too much, you know, I like the wonder of the first season. There's a little bit, I don't know, it's putting me on edge for some reason. I'm like, you guys are all so angry. I mean, I can understand why they're angry, but I don't know. It's just, it's a little off-putting. And really, how bad can the shower be? Aren't you happy you're being decontaminated? So there's Docker Montgomery, aka one of the Power Rangers. That's his 80s look. I'm not a huge fan of it, and I'll tell you why. On another shot. This, I don't like this at all. That is so it. And they even look like they're in a sewer. They have the same circular, tube that they're in. I just think it's just so much like it. I think it's, and it's, look at the smack in the center, there's Richie. They're like, oh crap, the TVs went out. That's the worst thing ever. Now here you can see, they're like, let's put our love triangle situation aside to rescue this kid. And David Harbour's like, sure, but I'm going to hold him. Just, you know, so when we go outside, when our rider sees that I'm the manlier of the two of us. I don't, this too, I was not a fan of this because this reminds me of The Purge. Now I know that it's hard, there's like a lot of different material out there, but you really have to be like, okay, is this too much like something else? And this to me just screams The Purge. So it takes me out of it for a second. That's what the problem is. I hated this too. This was really bad. I did not like everybody having a gun and arming up. I just wasn't a fan of it. And they're all like in a circle. I don't know. There is, again, it was too like, maybe they're like, everyone loves The Walking Dead, but The Walking Dead, oh, I don't like The Walking Dead, so maybe that's part of the problem. But never, The Walking Dead, of course, you know, everyone has to fight zombies. They have training every day. Every day you got to fight zombies. But this is supposed to be, you know, regular people. And again, I'm missing the sense of wonderment. This is just all hands on deck. And I don't know, it's just maybe trying a little too hard. I'm not sure. I don't know what it is. I'm missing the, like, the little slight sense of vulnerability. I don't know. There's just something about it I don't love. I just don't love it. And also the lighting on it's really poor. Now here's a lot of quick shots. Now, this reminds me actually of Eleven when she was doing her training, right, to go into the Upside Down. So that's interesting. He's also androgynous. Ah, that's cool. That's interesting. You know who else is androgynous? Dr. Montgomery. When I first saw this, I was like, oh, there's a new female character in the show. And I will see a shot of her in a second. I was like, is this her? And then I was like, oh no, that's Dr. Montgomery. Now this is a great shot. This is my favorite shot of Eleven, actually. Because you can see the softness, but also like the inner strength, and you can see the self-doubt and the fear, but also the bravery. I like that. That's, to me, Stranger Things. I like that a little bit better. Although Sophia Lillis over in It did a really fantastic job, and she was the only girl in a group of guys, and she has a similar hairstyle to what they've done with Eleven. This is a lot of similarities. I like this too. I like when these two guards or, you know, military police are firing off. That's fantastic. I like that stuff a lot. Everyone screams. Too much screaming. I think this is, we'll see who that is, but that's obviously, maybe it looks like a flashback or something. I don't know. There are others like Eleven, as we know, so I'd love to explore that a little bit. The old electroshock therapy. And there's the title. I think they should have used better use of the lighting and the red, you know, that's such an important part of it. Now, I don't like this at all. Their interaction seemed very forced to me. And he's like, do you still have the bat with the nails in it? He's like, of course I do. And one of you pointed out that he has his own Lucille, also from The Walking Dead. And I agree. You know, when you see this, you're like, somebody's already claimed bats with nails in them. Ah, it's tough. And, you know, I don't know. He's probably like, why am I hanging out with you and not Nancy again? This really, I did not get the good end of the bargain here. So I'm very curious to see it. I'm really interested in it. But, you know, this I thought, again, was the weakest. It felt the least 80s. It had the least of an 80s vibe. It had the least, you know, ambiance of all the trailers. And it had a little bit too much tension. Like, that's what I guess it is. But not tension like in an exciting way, in like a nails on a chalkboard way. You were just like, ah. So I'm excited. I'm excited for the season to begin very soon. But I thought, again, this was the weakest of the trailers. But what did you think? Thanks for going over this with me. And what do you think of 1984 as a year for movies? Of course, to this day still, I believe 1939 is the most famous year for movies. But anyway, write your thoughts down below. Thank you so much for watching with me. And you can check out some more episodes right now.